So hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and I welcome you to this series called RBI 24/7. So guys, it's day number 155 and I hope you are ready for the session. So before moving ahead to the session, a little introduction about your mentor. So my name is Mansi Anand and I've done my graduation from Sri Guru Gobind Singh College of Commerce, University of Delhi. After that, I've pursued my post-graduation from Delhi School of Economics, University of Delhi. And after that, I have cleared GRF in commerce as well as management. So guys, this was a brief introduction. And as most of you would be knowing that in this series, RBI 24/7, we try to cover some important financial and economic current affairs that can be of use to you if you're preparing for competitive exams. And now after the results are out for RBI, I think it's high time we gear up for our preparation, right? So let's move ahead to question number one for today. And before doing that, I would like to ask you guys to subscribe to our channel. So if you are a new entrant here and you're watching our video for the very first time, then do not forget to hit the subscribe button. It can help you to stay in touch with us. And after that, do not forget to press this bell icon. It is going to notify you whenever a new video comes up, right? You can also join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible. And apart from that, guys, if you have any doubts or if there is any topic that you want us to take up in the sessions, or you're facing difficulty with any newspaper article or any topic related to finance or economics, you can mention it in the comments and we'll try to take it up in one of the sessions, right? So guys, sometimes the topics you suggest, they tend to get lost when there are a lot of comments. So if your topic is not being taken up, do not get disheartened. Just try to mention it again on the latest video and I'm sure we'll try to take it up as soon as possible. But you will have to stay tuned to us, right? So moving ahead to question number one for today. And here is your question number one, which says select the correct statement about different types of credit. So very simple question, five statements given to you. You can pause the video and read these statements carefully, right? Moving ahead to the solution. So the solution is option C. So option C means that the correct option is this one. So line of credit is an open end credit account and installment loan is a closed end credit account. So guys, before you attempt this question, it is important that you know what is the meaning of open end credit and closed end credit account, right? So now first of all, let us learn about their meanings, then the question is going to be clear to you. Okay. Talking about closed end credit. So it includes those debt instruments that are acquired for a particular purpose and a set amount of time is given to pay these debts off. So very simple, if you are acquiring a debt for a particular purpose, for example, if I want to buy a new car and I want a loan for that, or if I want to take up a home loan so that I can buy a new house, then it is going to be a closed end credit amount because I'm buying it for a particular purpose and I cannot use that money for any other purpose, right? So you cannot go to bank and tell them that I need to buy a car and use that money to buy a house or use that money for any other purpose, right? That it has to be used for that particular purpose. And apart from that, there is a set amount of time to pay it off, right? So there are monthly EMIs that are deducted from your account. You have to maintain balance for them in your accounts so that the lender can deduct that amount and you can pay that debt off within a particular time period, right? So there is a structure to this type of loan, this credit closed end credit account. So the name tells you it's a credit account. That means you have taken a loan. There is a liability. There is a credit, right? So at the end of a set period, the individual or the business must pay the entirety of the loan, including any interest payments or maintenance fee. So whatever are the charges, they have to be cleared within a stipulated period of time. So the exceptions can be of current situation where there is a pandemic or where the central bank delays all the EMIs and they provide some sort of exemption. But generally, in normal circumstances, closed end credit accounts, they have to be cleared within a certain period of time, and they are used for a particular purpose, right? After that, moving ahead to open end credit account. So open end credit account, first point, not restricted to a specific use or duration, right? So see, there are many businesses which avail the facility of line of credit, or we use credit cards. So if you have a credit card, there is no restriction on its usage. So you have a particular limit. Let's say you have a limit of 1 lakh. It means you can use money till rupees 1 lakh, but there is no restriction on the purpose. You can use it for buying clothes, you can use it for buying shoes, or you can use it for paying off your any fees, right? So, or you can use it for buying anything. So basically, no restriction on the usage of this fund. That's an open amount that is available to you, but the only restriction is of a limit that you have to follow, that you cannot spend beyond 1 lakh, right? So this is an open end credit account. After that, these debt instruments set a maximum amount. As I just told you, there is a limit, and require monthly payments based on the size of outstanding balance, right? So that's a closed end credit account and open end credit account. So the open end credit account, it shares features with revolving credit, in which there is no fixed time to pay the debt off, or there is a limit, or there is not a fixed amount, right? The amount that you have to pay back depends upon how much you spend from this limit, right? So moving back to the question, here was your question. So line of credit is an open end credit account. So line of credit, as I just gave you the example, that there is a limit, and if you stay within that limit, you are allowed to spend. If you go beyond that, you're not allowed, right? So that is a line of credit, that is a credit facility, or you can say it is a loan facility that you can use, and there is no restriction on purpose or usage of funds. After that, installment loan, it is a closed end facility or closed end credit account because it is used for a certain purpose and there is more structure to it, or the payments, the repayments are more structured as compared to the open end credit account, right? So I hope the question is clear to you. Moving ahead. Okay, here is your second question for today, which says a DASH is responsible for the obligations immediately, whereas a DASH is only responsible for them, then refers to obligations after some triggering event. So three type of borrowers here given to you: co-signer, guarantor and co-borrower. You have to select the correct option. Moving ahead to the solution, and the solution says that the correct option is option A. So option A means co-signer in the first blank and guarantor in the other. So now we have to understand the meaning of these three terms, then only you would be able to fill this blank, right? Let us move to the solution. Okay, so first of all, talking about co-signer. See, the name itself tells you, co-signer, someone who is signing on a document alongside another person, right? So to co-sign is to sign together with the borrower to help them get approved for a loan or to get better terms on a loan, right? So this is co-signer. Don't worry, we are going to discuss it. Now moving to co-borrower. Okay, seems similar. Co-signer, co-borrower, someone who is borrowing alongside other person, right? Similar to co-signing, except that both individuals receive the loan and are liable for monthly payments. See, in both of the cases, what is happening? two parties are taking the loans. That means usually whenever there is an agreement of borrowing and lending, there is a borrower and there is a lender. So the lender gives money to the borrower and borrower then gives it back. So this is a basic lending borrowing agreement. Now in this co-signer and co-borrower situation, what is happening? There are more than one parties attached to this borrower side. So co-borrower happens when there are more than one party borrowing and all the parties have similar liability. Let's say there is a couple, there is a husband and there is a wife, they both work and they need to buy a new house. Now they buy a new house and they both are taking the loan, they both are co-borrowers, right? So this is just an example. Now they both are liable to repay the loan or to pay the monthly installments, right? So you can say that both of them are on the same pedestal, are on the same level, both of them are equally liable. So they are co-borrowers, they are borrowing alongside each other, right? Both parties are responsible for repayment obligations. Now coming to co-signer, see, co-borrower and co-signer, they both are similar, but the difference is in co-signer, responsibility primarily lies on one party rather than both of the borrowers. For example, there is a person who needs to take an educational loan. Now obviously this person who needs to take an educational loan does not have a credit history because this person is taking the loan for first time, right? Now how would a bank who is giving loan to this person trust on this person, right? Trust on this borrower because they do not have any information about him. They don't know whether he is a credit worthy person or not. So in this case, what happens is there is one more person, and so let's say this was Mr. A who was taking the loan. Now comes into scene Mr. A's father. Mr. A's father has taken many loans and he has a very strong credit history and he has been repaying his loans timely, right? So Mr. A's father is a credit worthy person or has a credit worthy history. Now Mr. A's father helps his son Mr. A to get the loan approved. So the father becomes a co-signer alongside Mr. A. So the primary borrower is obviously Mr. A, but here Mr. A's father, being the more credit worthy party, is helping his son to attain a loan, right? So you can see to co-sign is to sign together. So Mr. A's father is the co-signer with the help of a borrower to help them get approved for a loan, to make their deal or their contract stronger because of the co-signer's credit history, right? So this can be helpful in cases where the person who is seeking the loan is taking the loan for first time, so there is no credit history, right? Or let's say the person is very young, not very old in age. So many a times parents can act as co-signers, right? Primary borrower will, and now moving to the other feature, that only primary borrower will receive the loan and be responsible for payments. So in this case, the person responsible for payment is Mr. A. But in case Mr. A defaults, then Mr. A's father is going to pay the loan, right? So the responsibility is on both of them, but the primary borrower is Mr. A, right? So Mr. A's father, the co-signer, comes into scene when A is not able to pay, but the responsibility lies on both of them. So both of them are liable when the payment becomes due, right? Okay, moving ahead to the guarantor. Guarantor is a financial term describing individuals who promises to pay borrower's debt in the event that the borrower defaults on his or her obligation. So this is a pure contract where one person agrees to pay loan of the other person or takes guarantee for the other person. Guarantor pledge their
guarantor pledge their as collateral against the loan. So guarantor pledge their credit worthiness as collateral against the loan, right?
So see, the difference between cosigner and guarantor is, in case of cosigner, usually there are some knowns who become the cosigners, whereas guarantor can be a party or an entity who is specializing in providing guarantees, right? And apart from that, see, guarantee is triggered when one person defaults. So in case of guarantor becomes liable to pay when the primary borrower is not paying the loan, right? Whereas in case of cosigner, both of them are liable, right? So I hope now we get the difference between cosigner, co-borrower and the guarantor, right? So that is why in our question it was a dash is responsible. So the correct option was option A. Option A means cosigner. Cosigner is responsible for obligations immediately, right? As I just told you that both of them are responsible, but there is one primary borrower. And a guarantor is responsible only after some triggering event, that is the default by the primary borrower. And one more difference lies in the fact that usually cosigners are some related parties, can be close relatives or friends, whereas guarantor can be guarantor can be an entity specializing in it, right? Moving ahead to the next question. Okay, so look at the following statements. It here refers to, so two statements here it is mentioned, it refers to one term. You have to select the correct term. So the first term says it is a term loan offered against rental receipts derived from lease contracts. After that, the second statement says it is another method to obtain finance from bank or another financial institute or lending institutes. So you can pause the video and think for a while and then decide with your answer. The correct option for this question is option E. Option E means lease rental discounting or LRDs. So what is the meaning of LRDs? Quite simple concept, guys. Moving ahead to solution, here you can see LRD consideration is between a borrower who owns the premises, the tenant who has rented the premises or taken on lease, the bank or and the financial institute and corporate. Okay, seems like a very tricky statement. Let's try to disintegrate it. So coming back to the basic borrowing lending agreement, here is the borrower, here is the lender, right? Now see, the lender is going to provide money to the borrower and obviously the borrower would have to pay back to the lender. Now what is this lender doing? This lender owns some sort of property which is on rent. Now borrower is getting payment in form of rent and he is paying back to the lender using this money that he is getting as rent, right? So I hope you see, I hope you understand, this is very simple. The borrower is paying back the loan just like a normal contract, but he is using the rent from a property that he owns. So whatever he is getting as rent, he is using that to pay back to the lender. So basically the money gets transferred directly to from the tenant who has taken this property, to the lender, right? So this is an LDR arrangement, lease rent discounting. So basically using a property, using rent or income from a property to pay back the loans, right? So the tenant is not making payment to the borrower, but tenant is making payment directly to the lender. So this is the arrangement that is working, right? So that is why it is a consideration between borrower who owns the premises, tenant who has rented the premises or taken on lease, and the bank who is the lender. So borrower, tenant and lender, three parties here, right? Loan is provided to the lessor based on the discounted value of the rentals and the underlying property value. So basically this lender person can be a bank or financial institute. Lender has provided loan or money to this borrower on the basis of rent
that he is generating from the property, right? So the amounts are set in that way, they are based on the rent. So rent is considered as fixed income over a stipulated time, lease or rent period or tenure. So since it is a fixed income, so if it would have been some income that fluctuates, the lender might not have been comfortable lending on the basis of these receipts. So it is a tool to acquire loans from banks using rental receipts as collateral, right? So rental receipts are being put as collateral, that whatever borrower is getting transferred to the lender. Bank will examine long-term cash flow and provide the loan based on the exact amount. So guys, here is a question for you. Recently in Life Mint, there has been an article about a company, a very famous company into real estate, which is using this tool, right? You have to mention it in comments that which is that company, right? So let's see who gets the correct answer. So guys, I've been witnessing comments from you guys, right? Answering the questions that I ask, but that's really nice that you guys go and explore. So keep doing that. See, obviously I can tell you right now that which is that company, but exploring it yourself makes you retain the knowledge better, right? And you will be able to memorize it properly. You will be able to recollect it in future whenever you will need it, right? So it's good to explore some parts by yourself, right? And it also helps in peer-to-peer learning whenever you mention it in the comments, or even if you are unable to find the answer, you can still look at it in the comments, or you can tell me. I will try to cover it, right? So it helps in peer-to-peer learning. Moving ahead to next question for today. Here is question number 4, which says, central government is reported to have asked at least 8 companies it owns to consider share buybacks. What can be the motive of government behind this step? Very simple question. Let's see who gets the correct answer. Moving ahead to the solution. Okay, the solution says that the correct option is option A. That means generation of revenue for government. Right? So guys, this question is very simple, but we have to connect the two things: a government company or a company that government owns buying back its own shares. How is it going to generate revenue for government? See, this question is very simple if you know the meaning to the term buyback of shares. So I hope all of you are aware of this term. So guys, even if you do not know about it, you can ask for its link in the comments. Recently, we discussed this concept in detail in one session. So it would be good for you if you will study it first and then try to connect it here, right? So in this session, we tried to learn about Tata and SP, what is going on between Tata and SP. And there are many other companies like Wipro, TCS who have been arranging for buying back their own shares, right? So many companies are also taking the advantage of stock market's condition right now for buying back their shares, right? Now see, coming to this question, there is a government company. Obviously, if it's a government company, majority of the shares are owned by government. Now, we are talking about buying back of shares. If this company buys back its own shares, so from whom is it going to buy back? Obviously, its major shareholder, government. So, government is going to give the shares ownership to the company, and company in return is going to give money to the government. So, basically, it's very simple. You can understand it as an arrangement of government selling the shares that it owns back to the companies, right? So this is a buyback arrangement here. So this is going to lead to generation of revenue for government, right? So a very simple mechanism. Moving ahead, as you know, government is in a fix right now because their coffers have emptied by providing fiscal stimulus for the COVID hit economy. Our economy has been badly hit. It is in dire need of fiscal stimulus, right? So this is one way by which government can raise money, and they can use that money to stimulate the economy, right?
I think you can read it on your own. Moving ahead to the next question. So here is the last question for today, which says dash is a situation in which some countries make significant progress in reducing extreme poverty, but then find it really difficult to climb from being a middle income country to a high income country. Moving ahead to the solution. The correct option is option B. Option B means the middle income trap. So guys, if you have been reading newspapers on a regular basis, you must have heard this term, the middle income trap. So it is usually found in editorials in newspaper, right? So now what is meant by middle income trap? I think it's a very simple term, self-explanatory, that a country which is stuck being a middle income country. So many countries like India who have progressed. So if we compare the current time, okay, the pre-COVID time to pre-independence, we can see huge development. We can see progress that India has made, right? And many countries like India, they have made. But now we are stuck into a trap, or many economists are saying that if we do not provide fiscal stimulus now, or if we do not come up with reforms like labor reforms, land reforms that the country deadly needs, then we are going to be stuck into this being a middle income country. So you know that India has a lot of growth potential. It is one of the emerging economies, right? Fastest growing economies of the world in the pre-COVID times. So many companies, they want to take benefit of this. They are coming to India because there is huge growth potential. There is huge potential for demand, and Indians are consuming a lot and lot of products and goods and services, right? Which will lead to huge generation of huge revenues for companies, right? But the problem here is we are still stuck with some sectors, or we are devoid of reforms in certain sectors, which is pushing us back, or which is not allowing us to flourish with a pace, right? So that is being in a middle income trap. Unless and until we do something for these problematic areas, then till then we are going to be stuck here. So for labor reforms, you know, government has been bringing some bills, right? They are thinking of doing something for the land reforms as well, right? So they are trying to revamp agriculture also, but we'll have to wait to see what happens, what is the result of these steps that government is taking, right? So here you can see possible causes of middle income trap. Why does a country get stuck into a middle income trap? First of all, supply of labor dwindles. So usually in such countries, the middle income countries, there is supply of labor, human capital, lot of human capital there, growing population. But if it dwindles, it starts to fall back, the supply of labor, then it becomes difficult to expand. That is why lack of supply of labor can be one factor. Demographic transition model, falling natural population growth. So as a country becomes more and more developed, it is obvious that the population growth is going to be slowed down. But if it slows down really fast, at a fast pace, when the country still needs a lot of human capital, then it is going to be problematic. So we have discussed it many a times that in Japan, government has been trying to boost population because there is less youth population, whereas there is high old age population, which can be a liability for the country. So we need youth population to balance or to manage that old demographic, right? So if a country ages very fast, that can be a factor for being stuck here. Possible failure to invest in human capital if governments are not able to invest in health and education. So two main sectors to develop human capital, health and education. So you can combine skill building or training, employment into these only. Right, after that, new technology. New technology is very important to produce at a fast pace, or to have benefits of economies of scale, to produce on a larger scale. After that, institutions may not support an adaptive and creative economy
and society. So creativity is very important to find solutions, to find creative solutions to problems of the country. So for that, institutions play a major role. They should be open enough, they should be progressive enough, and they should be forward looking in nature. Apart from that, to build social capital. So taking care of your society, simultaneously taking care of the economy, right? So building social capital is also very important. So as it is going to support a sustainable growth, a growth which does not include society is not going to be sustainable. The model is going to collapse. That is why social capital is very important. Credit bubbles can develop as speculative investments take hold. So when a country grows at a fast pace, there is speculation going on its growth, or the money, there is entry of hot money. So what is the meaning of hot money? The money which can come and go out of a country at a fast pace, right? So if there is foreign investment that is coming into a country, but there are chances that foreign investment can move or exit, can take exit also at a very fast pace when the country needs foreign investment, then there are chances that credit bubbles can be formed if there are a lot of investors who are speculating on the country. So these are some factors or some causes behind the situation of a country becoming the situation of a country getting into a middle income trap. So for preventing this situation, government can take steps like, as we just studied, building human capital, investing in health and education, skill building, trying to promote innovation, right? And trying to build a sustainable model of growth rather than just focusing on economic growth. It is important to focus on building social capital as well, right? So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. So if you did, then do not forget to give us a thumbs up, because I'll be back in next session with some new information. So before ending the session, I would like to tell you one thing. So guys, on Monday we had a session on the Harshad Mehta scam, the Big Bull, right? So lot of great responses from you guys. So if there is any other scam that you want me to take up, you can mention it in the comments, right? And I've been getting some requests for Asian crisis, so I'll try to take it up in one of the session. And also I think regarding Harshad Mehta, there is a very nice video on YouTube that tells you through animation that how the scam took place. You can Google it and you're going to find it. And apart from that, you can watch web series that have been becoming popular lately based on this scam. Apart from that, there is a movie called Ghafla, which is available on YouTube itself. You can find it really easily. So you if you want to know more about that scam, you can watch them. Or if you are just a movie buff like me, or you like to watch such stuff, then you can go for it, right? So that's it for today, and I'll see you tomorrow. Till then, take care of yourself, keep your studies going on, and I'll see you in the next session. Thank you for being here.